Hey, how are you? In this section, we would like to talk about measures of central tendency. And we have three ways to measure central tendency or to measure the middle of the data. One of those ways is the mean, another is the median, and then finally the mode. And we'll talk about all three of these methods in this section. But first, I want to give you the definition of mean. So here you are, the mean of n data items, and we'll call them X1, X2, X3, X4, X5, all the way to the last one, is calculated as, and notice this says X, you read that X bar, it's X with a line over the top of it, that means the mean. Now this symbol, maybe you've never seen that symbol before, that is a summation symbol, it's a Greek capital sigma letter, and it means in math, it's used to add up a bunch of terms. So what this means is add up all of, and then whatever's after that, in this case, the X's. So we're going to add up all the X's and then divide by N, which is how many items you have. And listen, you've done this before. This is just average. You know, when you average your test grades, that's exactly what this is. So when you see the mean, I want you to think about historically, that just means the average. Like, just like when you add up all of your test grades and you divide by the number of tests. All right, so we have an example. Right off the bat, it says last year's annual sales in dollars for 8 different online businesses were as follows. And so we have sales of $374,910, $321,872, and I could read them all to you, but I know you're quite capable of doing that yourself. It says, find the mean annual sales for the 8 businesses. So what I need to do is I need to add up all 8 values and then divide by 8. So that's what I'm going to do. Now, when I added up all 8 of those values, that's a lot to add up, I got 2 million. Just had my pen ready and then it just blanked out on me. So let's try this again. So 2 million, still not working. Maybe third time's a charm. So 2,682,712. When I added all those together, and I needed to divide that by 8. And when I do, I get 335,339. So 335,339. Now, whenever you get an answer like that, or get an answer for mean, look at your data again and make sure that seems reasonable. You know, I've got my first value is a little bigger than that, 374,000. My next value is a little smaller than that, 321,000. My next value is a good bit smaller than that. But then this one's bigger, this one's bigger, this one's bigger. This one's really close to that value and this one's smaller. So without, you know, recalculating it, that seems like a reasonable value. But it certainly wouldn't hurt to add this up a couple of times just to be sure you don't make any silly mistakes. And then again, make sure you do have 8 values. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, yes. Okay, so just like calculating a test average, when you find the mean, you're finding the average of all the values. Now here I've got another example for you, calculating GPA. And so say you were at LBW and you were taking Orientation 101, and that's a 1-credit-hour course, and you scored an A in the class. And you're taking Math 110, that's a 3-credit-hour course, and you scored an A in the class. English 102 is a 3-hour course, and you scored a B. History 102 is a 3-hour course and you scored a C. And Biology 103, 4 hours and you scored a B. How do you calculate your GPA? Well, this is what we call a weighted GPA. Because an A in the 1-hour course doesn't mean as much as an A in a 3-hour course, right? So how do we handle that? Well, the first thing we do is we turn the letter grades into a numerical value. A's are worth 4 points, so I'm going to put a 4 out beside this A. and a 4 out beside this A. B's are worth 3 points. So the 2 B's, I'm going to put a 3 out beside it. And then a C is worth 2 points. This person didn't score a D, but a D is worth 1 point. And an F is worth 0 points, right? Because you didn't pass the class. And what you do to get this weighted mean, okay, is you take the credit hour, the 1, times your grade of 4. So 1 times 4 equals 4. 3 times 4 equals 12. So again, we're notice we're multiplying the credit hours times your grade. 3 times 3 equals 9 points. 3 times 2 is equal to 6 points. And 4 times 3 is equal to 12 points. And we add all these points together. So 4 plus 12 is 16. 16 plus 9 is 25. 25 plus 6 is 31. And then 31 plus 12 would give us 43. And we call those quality points. Now, how are we going to figure out the GPA? You're going to take your quality points. I'm just going to call it QP and divide it by your number of hours. Your total number of hours. And how many hours did this person take? Well, let's add them. 1 plus 3 is 4 plus 3 is 7 plus 3 is 10 plus 4 more is 14. This person took 14 hours. So we do 43 divided by 14. And I got, when I took my quality points of 43 divided by my number of hours, which is 14, I get a decimal. It's 3.07142857 1. Where do we stop, right? Well, typically, when we calculate our GPA in college, it just cuts off right there. It doesn't even get rounded. We don't round. We just cut off at whatever value that is. So this person would earn a 3.07 GPA. Now, remember, 3 corresponded to a B, so this is just slightly better than a B, super close to a B. And so that's how it works. And this is what we call a weighted average. You notice on that last problem, I called it a weighted average, but really a weighted mean. You remember, mean and average are really the same type of instrument. It's the same thing. The weighted mean of n numbers, x1, x2, all the way to xn, that are weighted by the respective factors f1, f2, fn, is calculated as follows. Now, remember what the f's are? That's the frequency. So, whatever your x value is, times your frequency, divided by the sum of all the frequencies. And in words, the weighted mean of a group of weighted items is the sum of all the products of items times weighted factors divided by the sum of all weighting factors. That makes it sound really complicated, but it's not. And we will do a problem where you can see it working. So if you'll notice on this page at the top right, I still have the weighted mean, that formula we just talked about. And example 2, they want us to find the mean salary for a small company that pays annual salaries to its employees as shown in the frequency distribution and the margin. Okay, so $12,000, there are 8 people that make $12,000. Remember, 8 is the frequency. That's how many times that $12,000 shows up. There are 11 people that make $16,000. There's 14 people that make $18,500. There are 9 people that make $21,000. There are 2 people that make $34,000, and there's 1 person that makes $50,000. And so to use this formula, remember, we're supposed to multiply, in this case, the salary is our X value, times the frequency. So instead of adding $12,000 8 times to come up with our mean or our average, we'll just multiply them together, and that makes it easier, right? Because really, there are 8 of these 12,000s. There are 11 of these 6,000s. There are 14 of these 8,500s. You get what I'm trying to say? Okay, so maybe let's do this in chart form. So here we go, all organized. Notice, just like our chart over here, I've got the salaries listed, and I've got our frequency, or the number employees, which is our frequency value. And what we're going to do is multiply 12,000 times 8. So I'm just multiplying these two values together. So I'm going to do my calculator, 12,000 times 8 gives me 96,000. And I'm going to put that here. If It'll let me write. There we go, 96,000. 1 times 16,000. I think I can do that without my calculator. 14 times 18,500. I don't want to do that one without my calculator. And I get 259,000 for that one. And then 9 times 21,000. I get 189,000. Again, I know you wouldn't have any trouble doing this. 2 times 34,000 is 68,000. And 1 times 50,000 is 50,000. Now, what am I going to do now? Well, it says in the formula, I'm supposed to add all these together. So add all of your salary times your number or your X times your frequency. And when I add all those together, I get 678,000. Now, that is my sum of X times F. I'm supposed to divide that by my sum of F. So it's not, I'm not adding the number of salaries I have. I'm adding the total number, or right here, of employees that I have. So I need to do that. I'm going to add 8 plus 1 plus 14 plus 9 plus 2 plus 1. And that gives me a value of 35. So this company has 35 employees. And then finally, 678,000 divided by the 35 employees gives us an average of 19,371.43. Remember, we're talking about dollars, so I just took it out to the cents place. It may even be reasonable to round it to the nice whole number, 19,371. It didn't tell us in this situation where we should round, so I just went ahead and went to the cents. Now, does that make sense? Does that seem reasonable? I believe it does. Our lowest salary is $12,000. Our highest salary is $50,000. And our answer is not lower than the lowest or higher than the highest, which makes sense when you're dealing with a mean value. It definitely shouldn't be any lower or any higher than the lowest or highest salaries. And it seems like that seems like it would be kind of right in the middle. Although mean is not always in the middle, but often it feels like it's right in the middle. And the middle is a different kind of measure, and we will get to that in a minute. But that's what I got for our mean salary. So anytime you have a frequency distribution, and that's exactly what this is, then it's just not divided into percentages. It's just a frequency table. Then you take your X value, whatever you're talking about, times the number of employees that have that value, or number of things that have that value, add it all together, divide by the total of your frequency, and then boom, there's your mean. Now we get to talk about something different. Median finds the middle of the data. Now, these are all measures of central tendency. So really, you're talking about the middle and just different ways of finding the middle of your data. And again, mean's probably the most popular. It's certainly how we calculate grades often. But mean is not always the best use of finding the central tendency of data. For instance, take the example I gave you just a minute ago, right here with salaries. Let's say this company had a person that made $500,000 a year. Let's just say it's the CEO, and then all the other people made between, right here, $12,000 and $50,000 a year. If we threw that salary into the average, that would make it look like everybody makes a lot more money than they actually do, right? Because that $500,000 would pull that average way up. But that doesn't really give you a good feel for what the average person makes at this company. The average person, I would still say, makes around $19,371.43. And then there's one person at the company that makes way more than that. So average or mean doesn't always give you the best idea of the data. So sometimes you want to use something different. Again, median is something else you can use. So to find the median of a group of items, here's what you do. You rank the items. That means put them in order, numerical order. You can't find the median without having it ranked smallest to largest is the best way to do it. You could also do it largest to smallest, but that, seems counterintuitive. Smallest to largest is the way to go. Number two, If the number of items is odd, so you have five items or nine items, the median is the middle item in the list. Okay, and I'll show you that in just a minute. If the number's even though, then half of your data goes on one side and half of your data goes on the other side. So what you do is you find the mean of the two middle items. You average the two guys in the middle. So this will make a lot of sense when we do a problem or two or three. So let's do that next. All right. So find the median of each list of numbers. As a matter of fact, I've got four problems here for you. And I just, on this page, I just want to focus on question A. So 6, 7, 12, 13, 18, 23, 24. All right. So the first thing we're supposed to do is put these numbers in order. So let's do that. And then you're thinking, well, Miss Wilson, they already are in order. Yes, they are. So I'm just going to write them down. 6, 7, 12, 13, 18, 23, 24. Now, I left our rules. We did step one. Step two, if the number of items is odd, the median is in the middle of the list. Okay, well, see, how many do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Hey, the number of items is odd. Now, you could, watch this, you could just cross these off. Like, this one goes with this one. This one goes with this one. This one goes with this one. And there you are. There is your median right there in the middle. Okay? Now, what's another way we could do this? Be thinking about another way we could do this. Because what if you had 101? Do you want to cross off at each end? I don't know, maybe not. Maybe there's a faster way to do that. So be thinking about another way we can handle that. But right now, let's just follow the steps. And if we learned a trick along the way, we'll incorporate a trick along the way. So let's do example B. Okay, here's example B. It gave us a little bit more room. You go ahead and start looking at it. I'm trying to get my pen to select correctly. Here we go. So we put them in order. Are they in order? 4, 7, 10, 13, 18, 23, 30, 35. They appear to be 4, 7, 10, 13, 18, 23, 30, 35. But now, y'all, if they weren't in order, we would have to put them in order. Now, how many do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Aha. Now, watch what happens. If I do that mark off trick, so I'm just trying to mark off each end. So 4 goes with 35, 7 goes with 30, 10 goes with 23, and 13 and 8. And that leaves nothing in the middle. So these two guys are in the middle. So what did it say to do? Remember, it said to average the two in the center. So, or take the mean. So 13 plus 18, and then we divide by 2 because we're just averaging those two values. So 13 plus 18. I really shouldn't have to add that in my calculator. That's 31 divided by 2. 31 divided by 2, you know, is 15.5. That is your median. So it's a median of 13.5. That is right in the middle of the data. All right, for example C, you'll notice our values are not in order anymore. And we have to be careful and write them in order. Make sure you don't leave anything out. That's what I tend to do. As a matter of fact, I've already done C one time and I left one of the values out. I don't even know which one. So when you look at your list, 7 is the smallest number. So I write down 7 and I mark it out. The next number on the list I see is 9. And then in order I see a 12. And then I see a 13. And then a 15. And then a 17. What do we have? A 21. A 32. And 41. Now, how many is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. My dog will not quit running around the house. I apologize for the claw patters. But anyway, all right, so they're in order. Now, we can start checking off. Remember when you have an odd number, like we do 9, we're going to have just one number left right in the middle. And if you'd like to start marking those off, you can. Again, be thinking about a way we could do this if we had 39 numbers instead of just 9. We might not want to do this marking off thing. So 7 goes with 41, 9 gets marked off with 32, 12 gets lost with 21, 13 and 17 go away, and that leaves 15 right in the middle, and that's your median. Okay, now let's try D. Okay, for D now, I don't know if you've been thinking about that trick, but the trick is right down here at the bottom. We'll talk about that in a minute. Let's put these numbers in order. The smallest looks like 132. I'm going to mark it off. The next smallest appears to be 147. I'm going to mark that off. And then when I scan, I see 159 is the next smallest. And then 174, 181, and 253. Notice there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of these. So we know that the average is going to be right in the middle. So again, I could do the mark-off thing. But what I want you to keep in mind with this mark-off thing, again, is what if you had like just a really large list? You may not want to do this. So again, if I mark those two off, there's nothing left. So I'm going to average or find the mean of 159 plus 174. I'm just averaging the two of them. I'm going to add those together. So 159 plus 174 is equal to, stand by because my calculator did me wrong. Actually, I did it wrong. It's 333. Divided by 2, and I get 166.5. That's my median. But what does this trick say? Okay, it says the position of the median. Notice it says position. The position of the median is n plus 1 divided by 2. Okay, so if we look at the problem we just did, the position is n plus 1. Remember, we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 values. 6 plus 1 says n plus 1 divided by 2. So 6 plus 1 is 7 divided by 2 is 3.5. So that's position 4. Or 3.5 actually is you average the two in the middle. So it's going to be 3 and 4. But for this one, okay, we could go back and look at that one real quick. If we use that cute little formula. So our position would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 plus 1 divided by 2. That's my position. Okay? Which is 10 divided by 2, which is 5. So that's the fifth position. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if you get a whole number for the position, then it's just that number. You just count to the fifth one. Remember, they have to be in order to do this. But the problem we just did, we got a decimal for the position. That means you average those two. You average 3 and 4 together, or position 3 and 4, to get 166.5 as your median. Okay, so find the medians for frequency distributions. Find the medians for the following distributions. So again, notice we have our, this is really your x value, and the frequency down here is how many times that showed up. So 1 showed up 1 time. The 2 showed up 3 times, the 3 showed up 2 times, the 4 showed up 4 times, the 5 showed up 8 times, you get the point, 6 showed up 2 times. So how are we going to do this, right? Now, the first of all, your values need to be in order. Now, if you wanted to, you could. Now, this defeats the purpose of having this nice and organized, but you could write it out just to see what we could do. We could write, there's only 1, 1, and then there are 3, 2s, so 2, 2, 2. And there are 2, 3s, so 3, 3, and there are 4, 4s, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 4s. There are 8, 5s, 3, 4, this is where it gets old, 7, 8, and there are 2, 6s, so 6, 6. There's your list. But now, and then you could do the marking off thing, see how that gets kind of old with a big long list. So I'm going to leave that, but let's do it, don't do it that way. And let's plug my battery up so I can keep going. Okay, so I'm charging. Now, how are we going to handle this? First of all, let's figure out how many items we have, right? So if I take the frequency and I total that up, so 1 plus 3 plus 2 plus 4 plus 8 plus 2. Let's add that together. We can certainly do that in our head, too. Maybe even faster. I've got 20. So we have 20 items. We could also count them down here, but we're trying not to do it this way, down below. I've got 20 items. Now we can use our trick. Remember, the trick says you have n plus 1 divided by 2. That's going to be the position of the median. Okay, so that's 21 divided by 2, which is going to be 10.5. So we're going to average together, right, the 10th and the 11th positions. All right, so how do we find out what's in the 10th or 11th position? Well, this is 1. And then we add 3 to it, so that's the 4th position. You take 4 and add 2 to it, so that ends in the 6th position. 6 and add 4 to it, ha! That ends in the 10th position. So, that means there's a 4 in the 10th position, but the 11th position, you have to move over to the 5 value, right? So, we're going to do 4 plus 5 divided by 2. That's 9 divided by 2, which is 4.5. So your median is 4.5. Did you follow that? Okay, so again, what did I do first? I added all my frequencies. That's how many data points I have. I have 20. And I used our trick that says you take the n, you add 1 to it, and you divide by 2. That tells you the position. So 20 plus 1 is 21 divided by 2 is 10.5. It tells me I have to average the 10th and the 11th position. Anytime your position is a half, okay, then you're going to average those two positions together. Remember, anytime you have an even, you got to average the two in the middle. The part that I may have lost you is, how did I get to the 10th and the 11th position? So this is 1. I already have 1, and then there's 3 right here. That means there's 4 already. And I have 4, and there's 2. That means there's 6 below there. 6 and 4 is 10 below there. So that means that 4, that last 4, is in the 10th position. And then you have to move on to get to the 11th position, which is this 5. So I'm averaging the 4 and 5, which is the 10th and the 11th positions. Let's try it again. I have another one like this. Okay, remember what we're supposed to do? First thing I need to do is figure out, because I'm just trying to find the median, is how many values do I have? So I'm going to add 5 plus 8 is 13, plus 10 is 23. Plus 6 is 29, plus 6 more is 35. Or just add it in our calculator. And when I checked it in my calculator, I also got 35. Now, to remember to find the position, we can use a trick. And the trick is, you take your n value and you add 1 to it and you divide by 2. Now, we already know if you have 35 or an odd number, your median is going to be just the middle value. Okay? So we already know that, and we're going to find out now when I do 36 divided by 2, I get the 18th. I don't get a decimal, so I don't have to average anything. It's just going to be the value that's in the 18th spot. How do I find it? Well, you could list, you know, 5 2s, and then 4, and then 8 4s, and then 10 6s, and then 6 8s, and then 6 10s, and have a long list of numbers and count to the 18th. Or you can work with your frequency. Like, there's 5. 5 plus 8 is 13. So there's 13 right there. We're trying to get to the 18th. 13 plus 10, that's the 23rd position. So you know what? The 18th position has to be before the last 6. It's going to be right there. So the 18th position is a 6, right? Because 6 is between 13 and 23. Matter of fact, it's going to be 14 through 23 is all, these are positions, are going to be all 6s. Because the 13th position was a 4. And then you had to move over to the next column to get to the 14th position. And it's the 14th all the way to the 23rd, because 10 of them are 6s. So the 18th position is a 6, and that's it. That is your median. Now, the third measure of central tendency is the mode. And the mode is what happens the most often. Okay. So can you think of a time where you want to know what occurs the most often? Something I can think of, and the book threw this a similar example out, but if you were selling clothes and most of your customers bought a size 12, that's a mode, and that means that's what you need to buy the most of is size 12. You don't want to know the average, okay, because if the average was 11 and a half, you're not going to order a size 11 and a half, right? Well, you might if it was shoes, but not if it was pants. So size 12 is the mode, and therefore you would order the most of those. And there's other uses of the mode as well, but I thought that was a really good example. Now, we're supposed to find the mode for these data sets. So let's just look at example A to start with, and then I'll slide to a new one to do B, C, and D. So example A, do we see a number that shows up the most? I got 51, 32, 49, 49, 74, 81, and 92. I think that mode's pretty clear, right? 49 showed up twice. So the mode is 49. It's not because it's sitting in the middle. Okay. These don't even have to be listed in order to find the mode, although it would help a lot because they would be sitting next to each other. But if you see a number that shows up the most often, that is your mode. Does that make sense? So I didn't see any other numbers that showed up more than one time. Okay. So let's try example B. Now, I'd like you to take a look and tell me what you think. I do think there's value for putting these things in order. You don't have to, but I think it helps. So notice there's a 482. If I put them in order, that's gone. I got a 483. A 485. Hey, there's another 485. A 487, a 487, and a 489. Now you notice I've been crossed those out. When you have values that show up more than one time, that crossing out thing is really important because you don't know, you know, if you write it down, you don't know if you wrote it down for the one or the second one or the third one or the 10th one. So I do suggest crossing it out every time you write one down. But this was helpful because I see that 485 showed up twice, but what else? 487 also showed up twice. So what is the mode then? How do we answer this question? Well, you know what? We have two. You have 485 and 487. By the way, that's called bimodal. I even have it written at the bottom right here, bimodal. Whenever you have more than one mode, it's bimodal. Now, if you have, say, three or four or five modes, you would just say you have no mode because it really starts getting into a problem if you don't have one that just shows up, one or two that just shows up more than the others. So one mode is fine. Bimodal is fine. Past that, let's just say we don't have a mode. Okay, so go ahead and take a look at C. I'm going to change slides so we can work on problem C. What I was going to do is put C in order. Those are big numbers, but when I looked at them, I'm like, none of those numbers match. Not even well, we've got two that are in the 10,000s, but you got 11,000, 17, 13,000, 12,000. None of those numbers match. You know what that means? No mode. Is that okay? Sure it is. A lot of data doesn't have a mode. It doesn't lend itself to thinking about mode. But then again, if you're selling clothes, mode's pretty important. All right, now how are we going to handle this D problem? And let me change slides on you again so we could talk about D. But be thinking about how are we going to handle D? When we had like a frequency table to find median, it was kind of a pain, right? I mean, it organized our information really, really well. But we had to start counting things and making sure we knew what position the median would be in and all that good stuff. When we were calculating the mean, we would multiply the value times the frequency and add them all together and divide by the total frequency. But you know what? When you find mode, remember mode is the one that shows up the most. That's going to be real clear. Look, right there. Look there. 8 showed up more than any of these other numbers. So there's your mode. Woohoo! So when it's in a frequency chart, finding the mode, that's the easy one, the one that shows up the most. We got a mode. All right, I'm going to wrap up this video because it's reached my, maxed out my 30 minutes. So I'm going to come back for a part 2 of this video, and we'll continue our conversation about mean, median, and mode, which is measures of central tendency. All right, have a good one.